Hey guys, welcome back to this quick home repair video. I know this is not my normal car content, but today we're gonna be messing with my Pentair control unit for my pool pump and everything. About a year and a half ago, this thing actually went out on me, the control, or the RS432 control that uses my app and everything, that also uses the antenna to send the information back to my router. It failed on me. The actual panel itself still works manually if I go in here and push the buttons and control all the relays. So today we're gonna be doing a quick diagnosis. I'll show you guys what to look for and this easy like $5 repair. So stay tuned. So if you guys know anything about pool equipment, Pentair is like one of the monopolies that controls everything. I mean, pretty much their pump, their filter, and all the whole system is all Pentair, and it's all controlled by this very rudimentary basic control system. But this thing costs an arm and a leg. I mean, this whole setup right here from a pool manufacturer or a pool contractor probably costs you like $2,000 or $3,000 just for the control unit installed, in addition to the pump and the all that other stuff. This whole setup is probably like $5,000 to $10,000 installed, which is a freaking crazy ass price for what it really is. It's very basic equipment and it fails all the time, and people usually have to call a pool contractor to fix everything. So today we're gonna go ahead and diagnose the board on here. After that lightning strike took out my digital and my scheduling control, I had to actually manually go in here and set all the valves and everything and schedule. And then on the pump itself, I actually had to go over here and use the manual scheduling and all that to control it. So for the last year and a half, I've just basically been set on the schedule on this thing and on that thing to control the valves. And then anytime I wanted to come up here and do any of the spall and all the different valves and different settings, I actually manually had to push buttons on here, on the manual soft buttons right here, so I could actually push them. So today we're gonna try to get this thing back with the app control again. So all the wiring and controls are actually under here for the relays that go all the way to all this stuff, and then all the electronics and everything. We don't really need to get into here to do our diagnosis. We just need to come up here on this part right here and take this down, and it's actually just two screws right here, and this whole thing flips down. That's the first thing you need to do just to do the diagnosis that we're gonna do today. So these two things just come off with just little hex screws or flathead screws. Just take that off. You can just fold this thing down. So here's your control panel right here that does all the digital part and the low voltage side. So before you even start on any diagnosis or taking this apart, you probably want to take a picture of all this and then maybe label some of these so you can actually put them back together and not mix everything up. So I'm gonna go ahead before we start all this or take it all apart, I'm gonna label these wires because they're not labeled right here. And then these wires aren't labeled either. So I'll put some piece of tape for 1, 2, and 3. Same with here, 1, 2, and 3. Same with all this other stuff. Just take a picture of it. Just make sure you guys know what goes back to where before we take it apart. But the first thing we're gonna do is diagnose the communications problem we have. So you have two issues. Usually, like if there's a lightning strike, this whole board will go out, or just the RS-432 board will go out. I think on this is just the RS-432 communications because everything else still works on here. I can still manually control everything. So what you want to look for, I saw this on one of the forums online. I'll post a link to it down in the description and also have it across the board right now. But down here, you can see there's a J20 plug right here. And immediately to the left of that, there you see these four holes right here. So those four holes go directly to the chip that we're going to try to test. So the very top pin is actually 5 volts. And then the 2 or 3 bottom ones are all ground. So we're gonna be testing the ground and the power to see what voltage we get across that. So to test the voltage, we just need a very basic multimeter. You could buy one of these at Harbor Freight or on Amazon. If you guys need a recommendation, I have this Craftsman one. It's a pretty old one I've had for a long time. But if you need a recommendation, just check down the links down in the description for very basic Amazon ones that will do the job. So I just wanna set it to the 20 volts right there. That's what we're gonna be checking. So what we want to do is test for 5 volts right here. So you can see the display up here is going to looking for 5 volts. Anything less than 5 volts is going to be an issue with your board. So what we want to do first is we want to touch the red of the lead on here to the positive pin. You got to be careful not to touch any of the other ones or short anything out. So you want to put it right there, and then you want to touch the first bottom one right here. So right now I'm getting 4.99, so that's 5 volts right there. So I'm good there. So the next one I'm gonna touch I'm also getting 4.99. And then the third one, you gotta be very careful on this third one that's really close so you don't short it out. But we're also getting 4.99. So the board is fine right there. So what that tells me is the chip, the RS-432 chip is bad. So what we need to do is, like I said earlier, we need to label all these wires, take this thing apart, remove this whole board, and then we're gonna go inside to the bench, desolder it, and replace that chip to see if we can diagnose and fix our problem. So I went ahead and labeled everything 1, 2, 3. I took a picture of all the wiring setups over here and all these spots so that way I could put it all back together. I'm gonna go ahead and unplug the main power here and just start unplugging all this stuff and then take the whole board out. Also, before you guys start taking apart any of this stuff over here and the power connections, you wanna go over here next to your panel with the high voltage panel and just turn off all the power breakers and everything for all your equipment, just in case something shorts out. So you wanna do that before you start any of the work. So after getting into here, I realized I didn't really have to label these right here because this whole actually connector just pulls right off the board. So just all you have to do is just pull it right off of there. So these are not any issue there, they only go back in one way, so you don't have to really label those. So now that we got everything cleared off as far as the wiring goes, go ahead and remove all these Phillips screws that hold the board onto here. Once you remove that, the whole board comes off and you can take it onto your bench to work on it. All right, went ahead and took off all the screws, left them all up here for now, and just go ahead and just pull this entire board right off. And it comes right off with the LCD. So now we have to go ahead and desolder this LCD board right here on top, which is gonna be the hardest part of this whole diagnostic and replacement. And then the chip is right underneath there that we can access. So earlier when I called these the RS-432, I meant RS-485. That's the communications interface that we're gonna be using here. And that's what they use to communicate between the pumps and the app and everything on this device. This is a very basic serial communication. And this is a very common commodity chip. So over here, what I ended up doing was I ordered two of these Maxim chips, which are the 1483. And that's the one that has the RS-422 and the RS-485 interface that we need. It's basically the same one that's on there now. So I ordered two of these. These were more expensive. I think these were like $4 each. Then I went ahead and ordered another brand of these same ones, which is the same model, which is the 1483. But this one's the Renesas brand, which is a little bit cheaper. Pretty sure it does exactly the same thing, but I ordered four of these just in case. These were only $2. It was worth just having both of them in case anything happens. So you'll notice these are just surface mount chips. They're very small and they're gonna be hard to solder. You're gonna need an air solder. So over here in my workstation, I've got this air solder right here that'll help me desolder that. And once we desolder it, we can heat it up, put some new solder on the pads, heat it up, and then just lay a new one right on top of there. So earlier I mentioned this thing right here. So we need to actually remove this LCD. This LCD is held on by like 16 or 18 solder points right there. So we gotta unsolder all of those. And underneath here is the chip. It's right around here in this spot. If you remember on the backside where we tested that J20 right there. So the chip is basically right behind where those four pins we were testing outside under the J20. And we go ahead and just unsolder this with my desoldering iron. Over here, I've got my trusty 20-something-year-old Radio Shack soldering iron with a little bulb on it. This thing served me well for the last 20-something years just desoldering stuff. If you guys can't get a hold of one of these, which is gonna be rare these days trying to find something like this, you can just use a regular soldering iron and one of these little suction pumps right here. So these little suction pumps that I've used before in my other projects, they can also work. It takes a little bit longer versus something like this that has the bulb built into it. Now that I've got this heated up, go ahead and get the first one. Just put this thing right over it. Let it melt. All right, we got most of the solder out, but there's still just a little bit of solder on each pin that's still holding on for dear life. Those bottom pins aren't coming off that main board. So the next thing I'm gonna try is to unsolder the top right here by the LCD. Hopefully it works up here better. These are much easier traces, bigger holes to get through versus the bottom, which is going into smaller traces and smaller holes. So I'm gonna heat up the other soldering iron, the bulb here, and go ahead and just do all these things on one shot. Maybe they'll come off much easier. Yeah, desoldering it from the top here was so much easier than trying to do it from the bottom here. So on the bottom here, I'm about to go resolder these things back to the way they were just to hold again. But the top, we're gonna go ahead and clean this up with some solder wick just to get everything off, and then this thing will pop right out. All right, got it pretty much all off, pretty much loosened now. So I'm gonna try to get this last pin right here up and pop this thing out. All right, once you get it all loosened up as much as you can with the solder wick, just wiggle it out. Just kind of break some of the solder joints out. This last pin right here is the biggest pain in the ass one that won't pop right. I'm gonna have to cut it off. Right there, popped out. And then just kind of wiggle off and it comes right off. So before you put it all back together, just clean this up with some solder wick just to get the old solder off. Down here, since I took out all the solder joints, I'm gonna have to go ahead and resolder those back together. And then that way, those are holding tight when we resolder the top back. But I should have just started from the top from the beginning. That would have saved a bunch of time right there. Before I move on, I'm gonna go ahead and just solder these spots that I desoldered on the bottom back. All right, now that we're looking at the board, this is the chip we have to replace right here. It's the U5. We're looking at it upside down right now, but the chip on here is an 81483, which is the same chips that we picked up recently. So we're gonna go ahead and use the air solder right there to heat that thing up and pull it off. Then once we pull it off, we'll clean up the pins a little bit, put some new solder on there if we need to, and then put the new chip back on there. So it's very delicate. You gotta be careful not to heat up too much. We have this capacitor C31 right next to it that we gotta be careful about desoldering that one too when we heat up this one. So we gotta be just real careful with that air solder. So as you can see, as a reference, you can see that chip right there. We go over here on the new chips we bought, the cheaper $2 ones are the actual same chip. That Maxim chip that I bought, which was the more expensive one, is not the same chip. I'll just go ahead and put the cheaper one in here since it's the exact same chip I'm taking out. That way there's nothing wrong with it, but you should be able to use either one. The only reason why I ordered both is because when I saw it on the forum, they listed both as an option. I didn't want to bother having to reorder these, especially the shipping, which was like $8 on all these. So might as well have them both on hand for the shipping price. So I'll go ahead and set this air solder to 480 degrees. Be careful with it. Just kind of keep it over the chip that you want to take out. And then have your tweezers ready just to lightly pull it up, and then the weight of it should just take it apart. Just want to move it back and forth. You don't want to keep it in one spot. It might burn the board. So right there, came right off pretty easily. Go ahead and just let it cool down a little bit. Just heat the pins. So I'll go ahead and take a regular soldering iron, touch those pads, make sure all the solder's good on there, and then we'll put the new one on. I've got the new chip right here sitting ready in the correct orientation. I'm gonna go ahead and take my air soldering iron, turn it back on, let it warm up a little bit, heat the pads up a little. Remember your orientation, guys. You just kind of place it down onto there. Hold it down with the tweezers right onto the pins. And just heat. Just go ahead and flip it over. Hit the other four pins on the other side. You just want to put it on there for 2 or 3 seconds and lift it up. All right, we got it soldered back on as good as we can. The pins are all nice and coated. So I'm gonna go ahead and put the LCD back on, plug this in, and hopefully it works. So we got all 16 pins soldered back in for the LCD. Go ahead and plug this baby back in and hopefully everything works and I don't have to take it all apart again. Also, before we put everything back together, I'm gonna go ahead and put this inline surge protector between the data line, basically the data line that goes into the board, out to the actual pump, and up to the antenna that does the Wi-Fi communications with the rest of the Pentair wireless system. I'm gonna put it on that line. It's basically just the A and B, which is the two-wire serial communication in and out. And then you have one little ground here that you just do a chassis ground to the actual box. Pretty much plug and play, very simple passive device. Should provide a little bit of protection from any kind of lightning strikes in the future. All right, we plugged everything back in. I haven't put the surge protector in yet. I'll do that next just to make sure everything works. But I turned the power back on and it looks like the screen and everything works right there fine. One thing to test to make sure that you know the RS485 communications works, once you go down to your pump here, you'll see that the display is turned off, it's not active here. That's a good sign. That means that the pump is working right now. So I'm gonna go ahead and pull into the app and then the app should be working. So as you guys can see on the screen here, it looks like the app is communicating with the pump. So I just activated it via the ScreenLogic app and everything is turning on and working. So this is a success right here. So that's an easy $2 fix. If you guys have the ability to desolder all these pins right here on the other side and do that surface mount soldering on the chip. All right, so now we're gonna put in the surge protector. As you can see on the out end, I put in two wires already, which is the green and yellow wire. On here, it's also a green and yellow wire. The green wire is the ground, the negative, and then the yellow wire is the positive. So you should just be able to just match it. It's a passive device, so I'm not even sure what the in and out really mean, but I'm gonna assume the out is gonna be to the board and the in is from the pump and then from the wireless up here. So we'll go ahead and undo the connector, take those two wires out and put them into this side. This connector comes out too. So for this unit, there's actually some holes here that you can use. Just fish your ground wire down and then we're gonna ground it to the bus at the bottom. All right, so down here we have the wire. You just go ahead and just snip the little thing on the end, strip it back, and then just stick it in the ground bus right here for the main ground of the panel. All right, that's grounded now, so we'll go ahead up here and just plug it back in, make sure all the communications work, check the app again. So that should pass through. So we'll go check the pump to see if it's communicating. So over here, the pump reads display inactive and we should be able to command it to come on by just hitting the filter button here. So yep, it's activating now. I'm gonna go ahead and check in the app to see if everything works. All right, I just checked in the app. Everything's communicating correctly. So I'm gonna go ahead and button this thing back up. Hey guys, thanks for joining me on this quick video on fixing that board on here on the Pentair Easytouch. As you can see, it was a $2 fix, which saved us probably $500 just for the part and probably another $500 for labor if you had to pay a pool contractor to do this. It's a very common problem that happens with these boards, especially if lightning strikes nearby. I've read on those forums that these things go out all the time, and just this first simple diagnostics of testing to see if you have 5 volts will tell you if it's set fix or not. Generally, if you were able to still use all the features but you don't have the app control or the control of your pump, it's that chip. So go ahead and check out the links down in the description to all the parts that I use for this. If you guys found this video useful, give it a thumbs up. If you haven't subscribed to my channel to stay on top of all my different DIY videos, go ahead and subscribe to your channel. Turn on bell notifications, just get notified every time I upload a DIY video, whether it's on the house, on the car, in the garage, or whatever I'm doing. Remember guys, if I can do it, you guys can do it. I want to thank you guys for watching and I'll talk to you guys next time.